coming out to our TEDx Cranbrook Schools event. This is the second TEDx Cranbrook Schools community event we've actually done, so thank you so much for your participation. Before we actually get started with our program, I just wanted to say a few words. My name is Catherine Messi. I'm the interim dean at the Girls Middle School. I'm also the organizer of this year's event. This event wouldn't be possible without our fabulous speakers and performers. So I just really want to thank them for their participation today. Also, you'll notice in your program, we give a lot of thanks and recognition to those individuals who are part of our steering committee, the speaker coaches, division heads, and then we also have quite a few Cranbrook groups who helped in terms of funding this event today. And of course, last but certainly not least, we couldn't have done this program without our guests, our attendees. So thank you so much for taking time out of your schedules to be with us here today. What I'm going to do to start us off is just show you a quick video about TEDx. That way you have some background about this program in general. Enjoy.
Kenya to Colombia, from Iraq to Korea, in slums, in schools, in prison, and in theaters. Every day, people gather at TEDx events around the world to hear the best ideas bubbling up in their communities. Today, you are part of a global conversation about our shared future. So what is this TEDx? TEDx is an initiative of the TED Conference, a nonprofit devoted to ideas worth spreading. We grant free licenses to allow TED-like events to spread globally. This event today is based on the TED Conference format and ideals, but is independently organized by your local community. So please make sure to thank the team of volunteers who worked so hard on today's event. It's their ideas, dedication, and time that made it all possible. It's they who booked all the speakers. And the views you'll hear today are, of course, those of those speakers, not necessarily of TED. We hope their talks spark an exciting conversation among you. It is a day for curiosity and for skepticism, for openness and for critical thinking, for inspiration and for action. The more you enter into it, the more you'll take out. And now, on with the show.
Shri Velmuragam is a 7th grader at the Girls Middle School. She likes reading and making up stories on her own time. She also enjoys gardening and learning languages, which include Japanese, English, Latin, Tamil, Tegu, Telugu, and Spanish. Please give it up for this first speaker, Steffi.
Good afternoon, everybody. You're driving home from work on a Friday in the middle of January. You see a man at the corner with cars whizzing past. He's wearing ragged clothes, torn, not enough to shield him from the cold, shivering vigorously, but somehow still holding his hand tightly in his hands. Why does he stand there? Maybe he won't survive the night. Maybe he would get frostbitten. What brought him to that situation? Maybe he was in a job until he got in an accident. Maybe his childhood was too harsh. He might have lost his cognitive abilities. Would you feel for his situation and what he's going through? Would you feel for his pain and suffering? That feeling, known as empathy, can lead to kindness and harmony in the entire world. You can say hi, say a couple of words, give him a meal, or give him a blanket. That child, a frame maker, a leather worker, breathing in harmful chemicals. That girl who is forced to carry water for her family and is unable to go to school. That soldier who lost both his leg and his mind fighting for his country. There's that whole generation that was lost because of the bomb. Do you have a moment for them? That feeling, known as empathy, can lead to kindness and compassion in the entire world. Often, when we come across a situation, we run through multiple feelings such as sympathy, sadness, melancholy, indifference, empathy, and fear. The end result is determined by our societal and world views. In empathy, there is a sense of togetherness, a we, together feeling, a companionship through heartfelt feelings, a sense of equality. Sympathy has a giver-receiver aspect. There is a sense of superiority, possibly a subtle sense of superior-inferior. So it is believed that a good deed out of empathy is more noble than a deed out of sympathy. Now I would like to share with you a story of three boys in Chennai. Some time ago, my mom was talking about the bravery of three kids. I got fascinated about it and read the NDTV article. On November 30th, 2015, Chennai was severely flooded and 266 millimeters of rain fell in 24 hours. Flights and trains were canceled. The road was full with rainwater. Many civilians lost their homes, lost their lives and their livelihood. They climbed to the top of tall buildings to save themselves. Police, army, and civilians worked to rescue others. Ashok, Arumugam, and Arjun are between ages 8 to 14. They look small and lean for their age. They lived on the pavement. Their homes were washed away in the flood. That did not stop them from saving more than 200 people. Yes, these small children saved people who were stuck in the Chennai floods. They did not know proper swimming. The only experience they had was jumping into the pond and trying to swim. But with that experience and only having an aim to save people, they swam and saved those lives. They did not have proper food as normal children do. They did not have breakfast, lunch, or dinner, only food time. The point that touched me the most was when the helicopters dropped food. They took the food and they swam and delivered it to the children on the terrace. They had no feelings or anything of why they were doing it. They just delivered the food. When they were asked why they had delivered the food to the children before they ate for themselves, they said that they were used with hunger. The children on the terrace had their meals regularly. They couldn't go for long without food. That was why they had delivered the food first. They were given bravery awards, but they had no idea why they had been given. The reporters urged them to talk about their experience, but they had nothing to say. They just looked at each other and passed the mic back. Their empathy says more than their experience. Now I would like to share a story that I learned in the sixth grade. It is called What Do Fish Have to Do with Anything? By Avi. In the story, a little boy called Willie has long conversations with his mother about a man on the corner. They stayed in my mind for long, because we see these kind of prejudices to varying degrees common among us, including in my family. Now, a short piece after the mother calls the police, displacing the man. I couldn't care less, but he might as well know. I arranged for him to be gone. Willie stopped short. What do you mean? I call the police. We don't need a nuisance like that around here. Pestering kids. He wasn't pestering me. Of course he was. How do you know? Willie, I have eyes. I can see. Willie glared at his mother. No, you can't. You're a fish. You live in a cave. William came out of the cave. Would you like to come out and make a difference? It is possible to raise empathy in children. Learn a new language from a friend or a colleague. Know what your neighbor cooked today. Watch a movie not for the sensationalism, but watch it and put yourself in the story. It is possible parents and teachers can develop it in children through objective activities. Now I would like to conclude with a beautiful song with a moral appeal. It was rendered at the United Nations on October 23rd, 1966 on the occasion of the UN Day. My dream bajata akila vijay dream. My dream bajata akila vijay dream. Atma vadeva paranabhi pashyata. Atma vadeva paranabhi pashyata. Yuddham tyajata. Spartam tyajata, yuddham tyajata, spartam tyajata, tyajata pareshma, kramamatramanam. Tyajata pareshma, kramamatramanam. My dream bhajata, akila vijay dream, my dream. Bajata akila vijay dream. Janani prithvi kama dukaste. Janago deva sakala dayalo. Janago deva sakala dayalo. Janago deva sakala dayalo. Dāmyata dāta dāyatvam janata. Dāmyata dāta dāyatvam janata. Shreyo bhūyat sakala janānam. Shreyo bhūyat sakala janānam. Shreyo bhūyat sakala janānam. Shreyo bhuyat sakala jananam. Shreyo bhuyat sakala jananam.
A beautiful song with a moral appeal talks about empathy and harmony. It means look upon others as you are them. Thank you.
Next up is Shelly Chin, a teacher in the Cranbrook Upper School Mathematics Department. She has taught at Cranbrook for 11 years and is a member on the steering committee for Cranbrook Envision Secure. Shelly is the advisor to the Cranbrook Envision Secure Club. The club helps support families in the Cranbrook community faced with cancer and fundraises to make a generous donation to future charity for the Cranbrook Envision Secure event every fall. Shelly is passionate about her role as advisor and steering committee member because she is a 17-year cancer survivor. Please help me welcome my teacher, Shelly Chin.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm here today because I believe that everyone has a story, and I'd like to share a small portion of my story with you. 17 years ago, at the age of 31, I was diagnosed with breast cancer. And while at the time that seems like a scary diagnosis, we weren't entirely surprised. 12 years prior to that, my mom had been diagnosed with breast cancer. The scary part at that time for my husband and I, when we sat in the doctor's office, was actually looking at the doctor and the urgency in her voice and actually the tears in her eyes. She said that surgery had to occur as soon as possible and that treatment would follow. The time between the diagnosis and my actual surgery was 4 days. In those 4 days, time seemed to pass very slowly. It's kind of a blur when I think back to that time. But there's one thing that was really clear during that time, and our girls were really little. We had a 3-month-old little girl and a 2-year-old little girl. I can remember, strangely enough, going to the grocery store and passing by complete strangers and thinking, they have no idea what just happened to me yesterday. And I looked at them and I wonder what their story is. I wonder if they have an amazing, happy story, something wonderful happened in their life. I wonder if they have a sad story, they lost a loved one, or perhaps they have a scary medical diagnosis ahead of them as well. But what was clear to me at that time, things changed, and honestly, I've never looked at a stranger the same. And it's something that I always play over and over again in my head. So as the years went by, it's something that you don't think about as much, and it's something that you just deal with your family. And I had so much love and so much support that they got us through a very difficult time, and for that I'm very thankful. Well, today we're here at Cranbrook to talk about empathy. And I think empathy is the ability to put ourselves in someone else's shoes and understand exactly how they feel, what they're feeling, what their concerns are. And as much as we'd love to think we can always empathize with anybody, we don't always have that ability. We haven't experienced the same thing. So I kind of feel that there's a fine line between empathy and sympathy. I can remember having to tell people in my family or friends what had happened in the diagnosis. And in that time, I felt so bad, because there's that split second when you tell somebody and they want to say the right thing and they don't know exactly what to say. They want to do the right thing and they don't know exactly what to do. But I can promise you that nobody during that time said the wrong thing or did the wrong thing. They always did exactly what they needed to do, and it helped. This community of Cranbrook is full of people that surrounded my family during that time. They're empathetic, they're sympathetic, they're just kind, caring souls, and they want to help. Well, fast forward to 2009, and now our girls are grown up, and they're at Brookside, and I'm back to doing what I love very much, and that's teaching in the classroom. And at this point in 2009, I've been at Cranbrook for 3 years, and I'm having a lunch conversation with somebody, and I hear about the event Cranbrook Envisions a Cure. Currently, the event has been going on. This will be our 9th year this fall. But at this point, it was the inaugural year. And Cranbrook Envisions a Cure is a time when the Cranbrook community comes together and other people outside of the community, and we meet on this beautiful campus in the fall beside Kingswood Lake. And families that have struggled with cancer or are interested in finding a cure for cancer come together and share stories and walk together around Kingswood Lake, and I knew it was something that I wanted to help with. So I reached out to the lady that started it, and she too was a breast cancer survivor and at the time worked at Brookside School, and I asked if I could help. Well, it's 8 years later, and every year the event becomes more and more wonderful. And a couple years ago, we meet after the event every year and talk about what went well and what we could do better in the future. And this one particular year, we thought we would love more people to know about this event. We want more people to be here because we would hear from them. I wish I would have known I would have attended. I had no idea that was going on. And as a teacher in the upper school, I thought maybe there was something that I could do. We have many, many clubs at Cranbrook Upper School, but we didn't have this club, Cranbrook Envisions a Cure Club, and it just kind of flowed real nicely. So I reached out to some students, and with their help and their hard work and their determination, we created 2 years ago Cranbrook Envisions a Cure Club. In our first year, we had a very successful fundraiser, and this past fall, we were able to give donations to 4 of the main charities that attended the event, large donations. And what's special about that event each fall is every single charity that shows up at Cranbrook Envisions a Cure has a special Cranbrook connection to our community, whether it's an alum, a student, or a family that has struggled with cancer. This year, we've had another successful year with our club. We have 20 members, and the featured charity for this coming fall is Gilda's Club. Next month, the students of our club will travel to Royal Oak and present Gilda's club with a very large donation for a memorial garden that they'll be planting as soon as the weather warms up. So that's a little of the background of how I became involved with Cranbrook and Vision Secure and the club. In closing today, I know a cancer diagnosis is scary for any family, and I know that we don't always get the outcome that we had hoped for. My family knows this because we lost my mom 2.5 years ago to breast cancer. But for my story, there were two little girls that we were really worried about. I'm sorry. And last June, my oldest, I was able to give her her diploma from Grandma. And that little 3-month-old, 2 nights ago, I gave her her junior ring. So I'm very thankful
and grateful. Thanks. Matthew Forbes is currently a sophomore at Cranbrook with dreams of becoming an entrepreneur in the future. His interests include developing an innovative app. He knows that not everyone learns the same way and is interested in telling his story about dyslexia and how it has impacted his everyday life. He hopes that everyone will gain a greater understanding of this invisible learning difference. Please join me in welcoming Matthew Forbes.
Hello and good afternoon. I am dyslexic. This means I have difficulty interpreting words, letters, and other symbols. I also have difficulty acquiring and processing language. This puts me at a disadvantage for reading, writing, spelling, and sometimes speaking. In the third grade, it became obvious that I was falling behind in reading and writing, so my mom had me tested at the Center of Human Development at Beaumont, and I was officially diagnosed with dyslexia. It probably came to no surprise to my mom to find out that I was dyslexic, as my older brother Brad has been diagnosed with dyslexia at the same age and the same place. A team at Harvard Medical Center determined that dyslexic brains are wired differently than other people's. On the board, there are two brains side by side. On the left is a brain without dyslexia, on the right is a brain with dyslexia. The red represents what is stimulated when a person is reading, and there's a very large difference between them each. Dyslexia was often also referred to as word blindness. And it was considered that these kids were dumb, poor spellers, and weak readers, and they were left behind. Fortunately now, times have changed, and much more is known about this learning difference. These students were considered to be dumb and lazy. If they were left behind, they were considered that they had to catch up on their own in their spare time, which we all know students don't want to do that. But fortunately now, times have changed, and much more is known about the learning difference, even though it can be very misunderstood. I want everyone to close their eyes and imagine that there's an invisible rope tied around their legs, and everyone is treating you as if you can walk without special assistance. You can't keep up and you can't figure out why everyone's going faster than you. And this can lead to low self-esteem and being frustrated when teachers try to leave you behind or you can't keep up and you can't figure out why everyone's going faster than you. From an early age, I can remember feeling different. I remember in elementary school, I would pull the sick card just to get out of reading class because I was scared the word I was trying to say would not make any sense and I'll get laughed at. Sometimes I feel that we are measuring people by their ability to read, write, and do mathematics. Dyslexia has impacted my ability to take notes in class, learn a foreign language, organize papers, and even completing homework on time. The simplest things can be made so hard for someone who is dyslexic. Fortunately now, students are protected under law by Section 504. Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973 provides protection against discrimination for individuals who are dyslexic or have other disabilities. Its aim is to provide equal academic access to help those students become smarter or get more attention in class if needed. Section 504 has given me the option to waive a foreign language, receive teacher's notes, get extra time on a task, and even get the use of a calculator. Dyslexia is a cognitive disability, which basically means it takes words longer to be processed. A very large misconception that goes with dyslexia is that I am not as smart or as gifted as everyone else. This is just not true. It does not mean I have a lower IQ than you. It just means that I learn in different ways, and accommodations need to be put in place to help me become more successful. Research shows that people who are dyslexic would rather miss class or hide their disability than be singled out by his or her peers. People would rather do poorly in class than be labeled weird, or different, or stupid, or unable to function with everyone else in society. Teachers are becoming more aware of students who are dyslexic by programs that have been implemented in their schools, but I think that many students fully will never understand what it's like. There are still many students who believe that getting extra time on a task or the use of a calculator or not using a foreign language is a leg up or a form of cheating. This is not true. It really gives me a level playing field to compete with everyone else. Imagine you have a prescription for glasses, but when it came time to take your driver's test, you were unable to wear them. You would most likely fail your test. But clearly things have improved, especially with the advancement of technology. I use many apps on a daily basis, which helps level the playing field or helps me learn in a better way. One of which is Learning Alley. This allows all of my textbooks to be transformed into an audio version so I can fully understand what I'm reading. Another favorite is Kurzweil 3000. This allows all of my tests and quizzes to be transformed into an audio version so I can fully understand what I am being tested on or learning. But I definitely do not want sympathy, yet I would like to see instructional techniques developed to help teachers fully understand what it's like to be dyslexic. But there are still many wonderful stories of people who are dyslexic. And did you know that Albert Einstein was dyslexic? And he's done so many wonderful things. But one of my favorite quotes by him is, "Everybody is a genius. What if you judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree? It will live its whole life believing that it is stupid." And I can really relate to this quote. By going to Cranbrook, we are put in small classes, like 15 or 16 kids, which is good because it gives teachers a lot of one-on-one time with other students. And this allows them to learn on how they learn or how they function in the classroom, so they can help them if need be. But the example, if we are in a class and the teacher goes, "Hey, Matt, can you read this paragraph?" I'm like, "No, can you have this kid read it? Can you have anyone else but me read it?" And the teacher goes, "No, you read it." Then at that scenario, this becomes my hypothetical tree that I am forced to climb. And if I can't, I'm left to feel stupid. Or if we're in an English classroom and we're reading our vocabulary words out of vocab books, I would count how many people are in front of me. So if I was fourth, I'd go 1, 2, 3, 4. And if I'm number 4, I would open my book and find 1, 2, 3, 4. And I would read that sentence as many times as I possibly could. So when the teacher came around to me, I would have that sentence basically memorized, so I'd be proud of myself. And that scenario, this becomes my hypothetical tree that I'm forced to climb. But Cranbrook has helped me get all the accommodations that I need. So it allowed me to climb the tree, and I'm not left feeling stupid. But there are many other wonderful people who have become successful, like Bill Gates and Charles Schwab, all very successful CEOs, and Steven Spielberg, Muhammad Ali, and Tom Cruise. But the person who has inspired me the most is my older brother, Brad. And I watched him overcome challenges with administration, teachers, advisors, academic deans, and other students to get all the accommodations that he deserves. He has paved the way for me to become a more successful learner. And he has helped me advocate for myself, which I hope I can do for others. But in the future, I hope that we will not judge people by their ability to read, write, and do mathematics, but yet their ability to apply everyday knowledge to everyday scenarios. And today I've learned that it is better to be different. Thank you.
Associate Professor in the School of Education in the Department of History at University of Michigan. He is also the Director of U of M's World History and Literature Initiative and the Faculty Lead on the Big History Project. Before coming to the University of Michigan in 1998, He taught high school history and social studies for 26 years in Cleveland, Ohio area. Bob's research centers on teaching and learning history and the social sciences in classrooms, online, in museums, and homes. Currently, he is studying distinctive approaches to doing and to teaching history across multiple scales of time and space. From his years teaching history in secondary schools and more recently as the faculty lead on the Big History Project, please give it up for Bob Bain, U of M professor.
So, I didn't limp out here in some ploy for your empathy. Nor am I going to make any kind of ridiculous claim that says if you need to understand me, you must walk a mile in my surgical boot. Rather, what I want to do is I want to focus on ways in which we can add new perspectives, and in this case, 14 billion years of time, in order for you to see more clearly the present. Now, I love the title of this TEDx conference because I was really impressed with the part after the colon. This exploring perspective and problem solving. The reason for that is I've been involved in a project, the Big History Project, an attempt to bring 14 billion years of time to high school students across the globe that is centered around exploring perspective. And so I'm going to get to empathy, but going through the colon part of it, the afterwards, that sounds awful, going through the colon, by exploring perspectives, the ways in which the Big History Project does. So first, we look at things that are close up and far away. And by that, I'm going to give you some examples of things that I can show you close up or far away. For example, here's a close-up look at something. Do you recognize it? That gives you a very different perspective of something that I'm sure you're quite familiar with. Let me show you a little further away perspective of it. So the idea behind shifting perspective is it gives you a different understanding of an object that's quite familiar. So on the left, you can see how the girder holds up the Eiffel Tower. And on the right, you can begin to see, you can see it, that where the Eiffel Tower is located in Paris. Let me give you three other looks at the Eiffel Tower. All of these are different perspectives. They give you a slightly different understanding of something that might be familiar to you. Let me show you another one. So I'm going to give you a perspective of this gentleman. There's actually a woman that he's picnicking with. But let me show you a close-up and far-away look at it. Now you're still looking at the same person. And with each move away, it shifts your understanding, or should, about what you can see about that person. Let me give you another one, one that actually is familiar. Jared, would you go ahead and roll this one? Yep. That's it. Good. Ah, there is a perspective of Springfield. Exactly the experience that I want to give you. Why? And what I want to do is also then take you through another perspective that we're doing in the Big History Project, which is long ago in the present. But here what we're doing is we're looking at time, huge perspectives of time, actually some going back 13.82 billion years of time. Now let me give you just a quick sideline to this. What is Big History? What's the Big History Project? Big History uses different perspectives to take a look at the present by using over 14 billion years of time from the Big Bang to the history of the future, all in one course for high school students. Secondly, the project, the Big History Project, is providing this course free for students all across the globe and teachers all across the globe. We're in at least 35 different countries and almost 1,600 schools in the United States alone. The idea for Big History was created by this gentleman, David Christian, a really good friend of mine who teaches at Macquarie University. He wrote this book, Maps of Time, which tells the whole story of human history, of history. He did a teaching company set of videos. What's interesting about Gates, about David Christian's perspective, is it's one cosmic story. So that what you're doing is you're going through 14 billion years of time, but it's all about this idea of how it is that we've increased complexity. Complexity is interesting because complex things are far more interesting than less complex things, but they're also far more fragile. So the story that we're teaching students, and that David's going through, is a perspective on how increasing complexity has occurred over time, both making things more interesting, but also more fragile. Now, the key piece to this story is the fact that that man, Bill Gates, you probably have heard of him, he watches teaching company set of videos when he's jogging on his treadmill. And he watched my friend's David's teaching company video on big history, fell in love with it, and said, why isn't this course offered in high schools all across the globe? And so he reached out to Bill, Bill reached out to David and said, can we create a project that will offer this course free to high school students? And since I've been friends with David for an awful long time, University of Michigan and I became actively involved in this project. Now what the project is doing is exploring perspectives, but it's doing it through problem solving. So we're engaging in authentic, legitimate problems. Let me give you some of them. Why would you look at things from close up and far away? Why would I take a look at my life from huge distances? Why would I look at the Big Bang? How has our understanding of the universe evolved and changed as a human species? How did stars emerge? And what did they give us? By the way, the stars gave us all the elements after hydrogen, helium, and lithium. You know that old Joni Mitchell song that says, we are stardust? We are stardust. Stars gave us all the elements. How did the sun and the earth and the planets form? How do you define life and what do you know about it? How did our ancestors evolve and live? How did farming change the way human beings live? And how and why has the rate of change accelerated? And then we take students through the last half of part of the courses. So what's coming next? What's the future like? All of these things are involving perspective. We also have big problems, and here's one that I'm going to come back to. How and why have our ideas and the practice of human rights changed over time? And this is all of us as a human species. Now, the idea behind here is that we're reconnecting learners to the things that they were curious about from the beginning. And learners are curious about the cosmos. We connect it to the concept that they're doing in the high school and back to their curiosity. We have an amazing faculty because part of the perspective is different disciplinary perspective. So all these people offer courses, keep a little section of lectures in our course, including a physicist, a cosmologist, the character down there with the beret, Walter Alvarez, is a Berkeley professor. He and his father proved that the asteroids wiped out the Yucatan Peninsula wiped out the dinosaurs. And there's even those old historians. We also involve people from across time. So the students are looking at perspectives from a whole cast of human characters to explain how things have changed. We also have a perspective that we call claim testers. So one perspective is, how is it that you know what you know? How much of it comes from intuition? One claim tester. How much of what you know comes from an authority? Another claim tester. How much of it comes from logic? A third claim tester. And how much of it comes from evidence, empirical evidence. And to help our students understand it, we've invented the claim tester comic books, which has all these claim testers who are fighting for truth and justice. Let's go back to this question that our students posed, because this now comes back to the question of empathy. So what I want you to do is to puzzle over with me this problem. It's an interesting historical problem. How and why has the idea of human rights changed over time? How is it different for us than it was for our ancestors? Well, let me take you through a very quick 12,000-year history of human rights. Human rights begins in origin stories. And if you look up there, all communities had their own origin stories. The Zulus, the Iroquois, Judeo-Christian. Those all origin stories explain something about human beings. And all of them are bounded to the community that they live in. So they are making claims about humans. But because most of them didn't know about other places, they were bounded. Of course, that then moves into moral codes from religions or philosophy. Again, something profound here. All of these places had moral codes that made claims about human beings, but again, they're bounded to either the region that they lived in or participants of that religion or that faith or that philosophy. This eventually evolves into political documents for citizens. So I pointed up a couple, Magna Carta, the English Bill of Rights, the American Bill of Rights, the Declaration of the Rights of Man and Citizens in France, and the one that's a little more difficult to see is the Haitian Constitution, which is one of the first constitutions that eliminated slavery. But again, there's something intriguing in these. Even though they are talking about human rights, all of them have some limitation on it. So for example, most only apply to a citizen of that country. Or often, all of these enact things that don't treat women as exactly the same fairly. Or some of them, including our own Declaration of Independence and our own Bill of Rights, included slavery. So these people weren't exactly thinking about the universality of human rights. That changes, though, in the 20th century. And so in the 20th century, we now have an idea that human rights are for everybody. They are universal. Now here's the puzzle. Why? What caused that change? For approximately 12,000 years in human history, human beings bounded rights to either their own groups of people, their own region, or particular types of people like them, like men, or like free people. Some people argue that the big difference between this, the movement from bounded rights to universal, was empathy. Well, what caused a change in empathy? What might cause me, as a master, to see the slave as human? Or as a male, to understand that a woman has exactly the same rights or the same emotions as I do, or a child? Well, an interesting argument has to do with the time period from about 1700, really through the present, that has to do with novels. Novels. Think about this. Novels become a new phenomenon of reading. Literacy rates increase, the printing press is invented, and what novels begin to do is they begin to teach people about people other than themselves. Rousseau, for example, wrote about women and gave women an emotional life that appealed to men, that they understood. Or Dickens, all those books by Dickens, so that people would begin to understand children have the same kind of rights and emotional feelings as adults. The two books up there, Equiano, a Freed Slave, and became an incredibly popular book in both the United States and in England, began to treat the slave as having an emotional life. The same thing is true of Uncle Tom's Cabin. So the argument is that a new perspective, because people began to read about the emotional lives of others, they began to see and feel the other as human. Now that is a large perspective on empathy. On empathy that helps explain why it is you and I live in a world where we believe everyone has a universal human right. So empathy was a new perspective that encouraged to see the human in human rights. I just added 14 billion years of time to your understanding of the present. Our hope, by the way, is that this idea of shifting perspectives, bigger perspectives, can inspire and engage our students, your children, your friends, throughout the world to prepare them for the challenges they face. If you're interested, visit us in the Big History Project. And thank you.
You know the story of the two salesmen who went down to Africa in the 1900s. They were sent down to find if there was any opportunity for selling shoes, and they wrote telegrams back to Manchester, and one of them wrote, "Situation hopeless, stop, they don't wear shoes." And the other one wrote, "Glorious opportunity, they don't have any shoes yet." Now, there's a similar situation in the classical music world, because there are some people who think that classical music is dying. And there are some of us who think you ain't seen nothing yet. And rather than go into statistics and trends and tell you about all the orchestras that are closing and the record companies that are folding, I thought we should do an experiment tonight. An experiment. Actually, it's not really an experiment because I know the outcome. but it's like an experiment. Now, before we start, I need to do two things. One is I want to remind you of what a seven-year-old child sounds like when he plays the piano. Maybe you have this child at home. He sounds something like this. This child. Now, if he practices for a year and takes lessons, he's now eight and he sounds like this. Then he practices for another year and takes lessons, now he's nine. Then he practices for another year and takes lessons, now he's ten. At that point, they usually give up. Now, if you'd waited for one more year, you would have heard this. Now, what happened was not maybe what you thought, which is he suddenly became passionate, engaged, involved, got a new teacher, hit puberty, or whatever it is. What actually happened was the impulses were reduced. You see, the first time he was playing with an impulse on every note. And the second with an impulse every other note. You can see it by looking at my head. The nine-year-old put an impulse on every four notes. And the 10-year-old on every eight notes. And the 11-year-old one impulse on the whole phrase. I don't know how I got into this position. I didn't say I could move my shoulder over, move my body. No, the music pushed me over, which is why I call it one button playing. Could be the other button. You know, a gentleman was once watching a presentation I was doing, and I was working with a young pianist, and he was the president of a corporation in Ohio. And I was working with this young pianist, and I said, the trouble with you is you're a two-buttock player. You should be a one-buttock player. And I moved his body like that while he was playing. Suddenly the music took off, took flight. There was a gasp in the audience when they heard the difference. And then I got a letter from this gentleman. He said, I was so moved, I went back and I transformed my entire company into a one-buttock company. Now, the other thing I want to do is to tell you about you. There are 1,600 people, I believe. My estimation is that probably 45 of you are absolutely passionate about classical music. You adore classical music. Your FM is always on that classical dial. And you have CDs in your car, and you go to the symphony, and your children are playing instruments. You can't imagine your life without classical music. That's the first group. It's quite a small group. Then there's another group, bigger group. These are the people who don't mind classical music. You come home from a long day and you take a glass of wine and you put your feet up, a little Vivaldi in the background doesn't do any harm. That's the second group. Now comes the third group. These are the people who never listen to classical music. It's just simply not part of your life. You might hear it like secondhand smoke at the airport, and maybe a little bit of a march from Aida when you come into the hall, but otherwise you never hear it. That's probably the largest group of all. And then there's a very small group. These are the people who think they're tone deaf. Amazing number of people think they're tone deaf. Actually, I hear a lot, my husband is tone deaf. Actually, you cannot be tone deaf. Nobody is tone deaf. If you were tone deaf, you couldn't change the gears on your car, a stick shift car. You couldn't tell the difference between somebody from Texas and somebody from Rome. And the telephone, if your mother calls on that miserable telephone, she calls and says hello. You don't even know who it is. You know what mood she's in. You have a fantastic ear. Everybody has a fantastic ear. So nobody is tone deaf. But I tell you what, it doesn't work for me to go on with this thing with such a wide gulf between those who understand, love, and passion about classical music and those who have no relationship to it at all. The tone-deaf people, they're no longer here. But even between those three categories, it's too wide a gulf. So I'm not going to go on until every single person in this room, downstairs and in Aspen, and everybody else looking, will come to love and understand classical music. So that's what we're going to do. Now, you notice that there's not the slightest doubt in my mind that this is going to work, if you look at my face, right? It's one of the characteristics of a leader that he not doubts for one moment the capacity of the people he's leading to realize whatever he's dreaming. Imagine if Martin Luther King had said, "I have a dream!" Of course, I'm not sure they'll be up to it. All right, so I'm going to take a piece of Chopin. This is a beautiful prelude by Chopin. Some of you will know it. Happened in this room. When I started, you thought, how beautiful that sounds. I do think we should go to the same place for our summer holidays next year. It's funny, isn't it? It's funny how those thoughts kind of waft into your head when we're looking together. And of course, if peace is long and you've had a long day, you might actually drift off. And then your companion will dig you in the ribs and say, "Wake up, it's culture!" And then you feel even worse. But has it ever occurred to you that the reason you feel sleepy in classical music is not because of you, but because of us? Did anybody think while I was playing, why is he using so many impulses? If I'd done this with my head, you certainly would have thought it. Every time you hear classical music, you'll always be able to know if you hear those impulses. So let's see what's really going on here. We have a B. This is a B. The next note is a C. And the job of the C is to make the B sad. And it does, doesn't it? Composers know that. If they want sad music, they just play those two notes. Basically, it's just a B with four sads. Now it goes down to A. Now to G. And then to F. So we have B, A, G, F. And if we have B, A, G, F, what do we expect next? Oh, that might be the flute. Let's try it again. Ooh, the tail choir. Have you noticed? You notice nobody is tone deaf. Like, right? Nobody's. You know, every village in Bangladesh and every hamlet in China, everybody knows. Da 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 da. Everybody knows. Who's expecting that E? Now, Chopin didn't want to reach the E there because what will have happened? It'll be over, like Hamlet. You remember Hamlet, Act 1, Scene 3, he finds out that his uncle killed his father. You remember, he keeps on going up to his uncle and almost killing him. And then he backs away and then he goes up to him again and almost kills him. And the critics, all of whom sitting in the back row there, they have to have an opinion. So they say, Hamlet is a procrastinator. Or they say, Hamlet has an Oedipus complex. Nevertheless, the play would be over, stupid. That's why Shakespeare puts all that stuff in Hamlet, you know, Ophelia going mad and the play within the play and the Yorick spell and the grave diggers. That's in order to delay until Act 5 can kill him. It's the same with the Chopin. He's just about to reach the E, and he says, "Oops, better go back up and do it again." So he does it again. Now he gets excited. That's exciting, you don't have to worry about it. Now he gets F sharp, and finally he goes down to E. But it's the wrong chord. Because the chord he's looking for is this one. Instead he does. Now we call that a deceptive cadence. because it deceives us. I always tell my students, if you have a deceptive case, be sure to raise your eyebrows and everybody will know. So he gets to even, it's the wrong chord. Now he tries E again. That one doesn't work. Now he tries E again. That one doesn't work. Now he tries E again. That doesn't work. And then finally, there's a gentleman in the front row who went, it's the same gesture he makes when he comes home after a long day, turns off the key in his car and says, I'm home. Because we all know where home is. So this is a piece which goes from away to home. And I'm going to play all the way through, and you're going to follow. B, C, B, C, B, C, B, D, down to A, down to G, down to F, almost goes to E, but otherwise the play would be over. Goes back up to B, gets very excited, goes to F sharp, goes to E, it's the wrong chord, it's the wrong chord, it's the wrong chord, and finally goes to E, and it's home. And what you're going to see is one buttock playing. Because for me to join the B to the E, I have to stop thinking about every single note along the way and start thinking about the long, long line from B to E. You know, we were just in South Africa, and you can't go to South Africa without thinking of Mandela in jail for 27 years. What was he thinking about? Lunch? No, he was thinking about the vision for South Africa and for human beings. That's what came. This is about vision. This is about the long line, like the bird who flies over the field and doesn't care about the fences underneath, right? So now you're going to follow the line all the way from B to E. And I have one last request before I play this piece all the way through. Would you think of somebody who you adore, who's no longer there? A beloved grandmother, a lover, somebody in your life who you love with all your heart, but that person is no longer with you. Bring that person into your mind, and at the same time, follow the line all the way from B to E, and you'll hear everything that Chopin had to say. Why I'm clapping. Well, I did this at a school in Boston with about 7th graders, 12-year-olds, and I did exactly what I did with you, and I told them and explained them the whole thing, and at the end they went crazy, clapping, they were clapping, I was clapping, they were clapping. Finally I said, why am I clapping? One of the little kids said, because we were listening. Think of it, 1,600 people, busy people, involved in all sorts of different things. listening, understanding, and being moved by a piece by Chopin. Now that is something. Now am I sure that every single person followed that, understood it, was moved by it? Of course I can't be sure. And I'll tell you what happened to me. I was in Ireland during the Troubles 10 years ago, and I was working with some Catholic and Protestant kids on conflict resolution, and I did this with them. Tricky, risky thing to do, because they were street kids. And one of them came to me the next morning, and he said, you know, I've never listened to classical music in my life, but when you played that shopping piece, he said, my brother was shot last year, and I didn't cry for him, but last night when you played that piece, he was the one I was thinking about. And I felt the tears streaming down my face, and you know, it felt really good to cry for my brother. So I made up my mind at that moment that classical music is for everybody. Everybody. Now, how would you walk? Because you know my profession, the music profession, doesn't see it that way. They say 3% of the population likes classical music. If only we could move it to 4%, our problems would be over. I say, how would you walk? How would you talk? How would you be if you thought 3% of the population likes classical music? Only if we could move it to 4%. How would you walk? How would you talk? How would you be if you thought everybody loves classical music? They just haven't found out about it yet. See, these are totally different worlds. Now, I had an amazing experience. I was 45 years old. I'd been conducting for 20 years. And I suddenly had a realization. The conductor of an orchestra doesn't make a sound. My picture appears on the front of the CD. But the conductor doesn't make the sound. He depends for his power on his ability to make other people powerful. And that changed everything for me. It was totally life-changing. People in my orchestra came up to me and said, Ben, what happened? That's what happened. I realized my job was to awaken possibility in other people. And of course, I wanted to know whether I was doing that. And you know how you find out? You look at their eyes. If their eyes are shining, you know you're doing it. You could light up a village with this guy's eyes. Right? So if the eyes are shining, you know you're doing it. If the eyes are not shining, you get to ask a question. And this is the question. Who am I being that my player's eyes are not shining? We can do that with our children too. Who am I being that my children's eyes are not shining? That's a totally different world. Now, we're all about to end this magical on the mountain week, and we're going back into the world. And I say, it's appropriate for us to ask the question, who are we being as we go back out into the world? And you know, I have a definition of success. For me, it's very simple. It's not about wealth and fame and power. It's about how many shining eyes I have around me. So now, I have one last thought, which is that it really makes a difference what we say, the words that come out of our mouth. I learned this from a woman who survived Auschwitz, one of the rare survivors. She went to Auschwitz when she was 15 years old. And her brother was 8, and the parents were lost. And she told me this. She said, we were in the train going to Auschwitz, and I looked down and I saw my brother's shoes were missing. And I said, well, you're so stupid, can't you keep your things together, for goodness sake, the way an elder sister might speak to a younger brother. Unfortunately, it was the last thing she ever said to him, because she never saw him again. He did not survive. And so when she came out of Auschwitz, she made a vow. She told me this. She said, I walked out of Auschwitz into life, and I made a vow. And the vow was, I will never say anything that couldn't stand as the last thing I ever say. Now, can we do that? No, and we'll make ourselves wrong and others wrong. But it is a possibility to live into. Thank you. Shining eyes. Thank you.
is a current senior at the upper school. Throughout her years here, she has been involved in ice hockey, theater, and social justice, and will be attending Millbury College next February after pursuing a GAPS master. Please welcome Courtney Wright as she talks about acting and empathy.
Good afternoon. Today, I would like to begin with the end. So, if there is one thing I hope you take away from my talk today, is this. In a world where everyone thinks they are right, it is better to think you're right and empathize with the other person than just think you're right. Now, about a year or so ago, I found myself in a small rural village on the other side of the Atlantic, shaking the hand of a boy whose language I did not understand. Ever since then, I have been fascinated with how very singular each and every one of our lives really are. We get one field of vision, two ears, one body, and depending what you believe, one life. All of us are living a distinct set of experiences and circumstances which no one else will ever live to the same extent we ourselves are. You are alone in your universe. Thus, it comes as no surprise that we do not understand each other. In a world where we are unable to share the same reality, it is no wonder we clash, which is why we need empathy. Something that allows us to share, if not a reality, a circumstance. Something to bridge the gap between our individual worlds. Something to create understanding. Now, what if I told you that at this school there exists a class with the sole purpose of teaching empathy? In this very building, in fact. If the name of my presentation hasn't already given it away, I'm talking about acting. Acting tells us two very important things about empathy. First, that pure empathy is possible. And second, that it can be learned. So, how does acting prove the existence of empathy? Well, when we act, we are trying to become someone else, become another person, become a character. To do this, we must understand and feel the emotions and feelings of that character. By very definition, what empathy is, the ability to understand and feel the emotions of another. How this is accomplished depends on who you ask. Acting is far from a new practice, and theorists such as Lee Strasberg, Stella Adler, and Michael Chekhov have been trying to figure out the best way to become someone else for years. However, one thing that is commonly accepted in the acting community is that you do not have to have lived something to act it. I believe this is because by age 18, we have already experienced all of our emotions, even at the mildest of levels. Certainly not every emotion to its full capacity, because up to this point, our external stimuli has differed. But every emotion is there, living inside of us. When we act, we are trying to use the circumstances, made-up circumstances, of our character's existence as a stimulus to induce a certain level of a certain feeling in ourselves. Thus, if we are able to approach one another with the same curiosity with which actors approach their characters, we can learn at the very basic level to act one another. And in doing so, we can learn empathy. We are live here at TED. In fact, I would go as far as to say that every one of you has acted someone before, whether or not you have ever been a student of theater or film. Have you ever tried to stand in someone else's shoes or seen the world through someone else's eyes? Konstantin Stanislavski called this magic what-if. It's a tool actors use to try and understand their characters. It begins by asking, what would I do if I were in my character's circumstance? It expands into a series of other what-ifs, such as, what if my character felt this way instead of that way? What if this happened? So, my challenge to all of you is to act one another, fall into the habit of acting one another as often and intensely as possible. Rehearse empathy. Pick someone in your home, school, or workplace, and take a moment to envision what they are seeing at that moment. Use your knowledge of their experiences to imagine what they are feeling and feel it yourself. You don't always have to get it right. Most of the time, you will not. Try acting a stranger, someone you see on the street. You'll find that with little to no knowledge of this person's life, your mind fills in the gaps. Empathy is a habit which must be rehearsed. Now, a curious thing about actors and our use of empathy is that we do not always act the good guy. Often, we must act the antagonist, the villain. We must empathize with the lowest of the low, the worst of the worst. This is accomplished by stimulating the emotions we are least proud of. Greed, hatred, jealousy, apathy. If you would, I invite you all to close your eyes. I want you to think of the worst person you can imagine. Someone so awful we can hardly consider him or her human. Someone so terrible makes you sick to think of them. Now, become them. Allow their field of vision to overtake your own. Become overwhelmed by their sensory intake. Use an abstraction of their experiences to stimulate the worst attributes of yourself. Now mix in a little instinct. Now stop. Open your eyes. It's unpleasant, isn't it? But that is an extreme exercise to prove a not-so-restrained point. You see, empathy is not endorsement. It is certainly not praise. If we are to successfully practice empathy, this is the distinction we must make. We need the ability to understand while retaining the ability to pass judgment. This is because conflicts do not often arise between people who easily relate to one another. Empathizing with emotions we completely understand is too simple, too easy. We must empathize with those who we are not like. In doing so, we learn the skill of empathy while maintaining our individual, personal beliefs and ideals, much like a character carrying out actions he or she does not agree with about the character. Acting tells us that empathy does not have to have an effect on our personal beliefs or actions or ideals. Because of this comment, I do not believe that empathy can save the world. Just because we are able to understand one another does not mean that we will all agree. But I do believe that by rehearsing empathy, those individual, singular lives and worlds we each inhabit can begin to have microscopic overlaps. And that could make all the difference. Thank you.
Suha Asadula is an 18-year-old senior at Cranbrook Kingswood Upper School. From an early age, she displayed a passion for the arts, specifically painting, graphic design, and video editing. She enjoys drawing, traveling, and is a founder of Painting Detroit, a nonprofit that donates art supplies to underfunded art programs in Detroit. Next year, she will be matriculating into University of Michigan. Please welcome Suha.
So I want to direct your attention to the screen up here. It says blank artist. Now in your minds, I just want you to fill this blank with whatever you feel is appropriate given the context. So hopefully some of you thought creative artist or successful artist, but most of you probably thought of the very famous thing, the starving artist. So what is a starving artist? Well, it's essentially society's belief that artists are less equipped for success in comparison to their STEM counterparts. I myself get asked all the time why I would choose to major in art and design next year at the University of Michigan. And the truth is, it's because I see the value in becoming a creative. Because at this moment, artists are at the forefront of innovation in our diversifying economy. And understanding, empathizing, and promoting this experience has become integral to the success and advancement of both our society and culture. So first I want to talk about art in the real world. Now I think this is a very important concept, because most people, when they think about artists, will probably visualize something like this, which is someone in a studio patiently painting and drawing for hours. Rather than professionals in marketing and design, the tech sphere, and even leaders in top-end companies. These are all sectors that require a real creative background, a propensity to think beyond what is given and find imaginative solutions difficult and pressing issues. In fact, in a recent study conducted by IBM, which surveyed 1,500 CEOs and public sector leaders across 60 nations, creativity is now the most important leadership quality for potential success in business and also for potential employment, outweighing even integrity and global thinking. CEOs from the same study cited the rapid escalation complexity as the biggest issue challenging them and their organizations. These same CEOs stated that creativity was the single most important leadership competency for enterprises seeking a path through this complexity. This is because artists and creatives are seen as more capable to break from the status quo of industry, enterprise, and revenue models. To sum up, the magnitude to which artistry is valued by potential employers should make it a top priority for us as potential employees. So similar to the last study, John Ada, the current president of the Rhode Island School of Design, makes the claim that the archetypal business person in a role of leadership is stuck on the bottom two rungs of this pyramid, where all decision-making is constrained by reality. Artists and designers, however, move past this rung into higher planes of problem-solving, which involve creativity, and finally, boundless creativity or imagination. Artists and designers are constantly trying to innovate beyond the status quo. Or as Nancy Adler from McGill University puts it, you'd be hard-pressed to find an artist who didn't approach a blank canvas wanting to produce something of high quality. But all too often, people in the commercial world end up settling for the just good enough. So this brings me to my next point, which is that we should abolish this view that artists are merely those who can paint a pretty picture. Now don't get me wrong, this is a very important part about, or aspect of being an artist, is to create beautiful things. But even more than that, I would prod you to look at artists as creators in the broader sense of the word. Because they are truly the innovators of the future, but also, more importantly, of the present. So, probably some of you want some examples of artists who have broken through the industry mold. Well, I'm about to share one with you that has essentially changed the technological landscape. This is an app that is probably familiar to most of you, and I know I use it on a daily basis, but this is Snapchat. And this is a great example of taking artistry and technology and syncretizing them into a product that is consumable by the general public. And in fact, its founder, Evan Spiegel, actually attended the Otis School of Art and Design before matriculating into Stanford University, where he studied product design. He is now estimated to be worth a staggering $4.6 billion, which I would say is not too bad for a starving artist. So finally, I want to talk about kind of the historical context and influence art has had over the years. When art is thriving, usually our society and culture is also at its finest. Some great examples would be the Islamic Golden Age, the Renaissance, and as recently as the Harlem Renaissance in the 20th century. These are all time periods that saw increased economic growth and prosperity, but even more importantly, the development of society where race, gender, and socioeconomic background were nulled in favor of continued scientific and artistic exploration and inquiry. Whether it be calligraphy and architecture during the Islamic Golden Age, fine arts during the Renaissance, or a new generation of African-American voices during the Harlem Renaissance, these eras show the importance of having artistically involved communities. Art has truly left our society for the better. And now, more than ever, it's no longer an option to empathize with artistic experience, but a necessity as we move towards a more technologically-based civilization. Similarly to art, empathy is not something you are intrinsically born with, but rather something you learn through shared experience and growth. So next time you think of an artist, don't see them as starving, but rather hungry, harnessing an appetite to change the world. Thank you.
Our next speaker this afternoon will be Mr. Gordon Thompson, a faculty member here at Cranbrook Kingswood. Originally from New Jersey, Gordon earned a BA in English and Music from Swarthmore College. During two summers with the Forest Service, neither Latin nor French helped him communicate with Mexican sheep herders. Over the next several years, he learned Spanish by traveling and studying in Latin America while completing an MFA in Creative Writing from the University of Florida. After teaching in Chile, he landed at Cranbrook, where he has taught English, led wilderness expeditions, coached forensics, advised the literary magazine, and worked in the dorm. Thanks to summer vacations, he's visited more than 50 countries, including volunteering at ASSET, the Gambia, and Tshume School in South Africa. Gordon has also been involved in Kiva to help entrepreneurs around the world. So please give it up for Mr. Gordon Thompson.
More than 20 years ago, I was hiking the Continental Divide. It was very remote, and there was no one around except for one man, one horse, and a whole lot of sheep. And he approached me, and since he'd been alone up there all summer, he was very eager to talk, and I was eager to talk to him as well. But the only problem was that he was from Mexico and only spoke Spanish, and I had taken French and Latin in high school. And it occurred to me that there was something rather sad and absurd about the idea that I was in my own country, in a place where there were no people, and the one person there, you know, we couldn't communicate. And so I decided then that I wanted to learn Spanish. And so over the course of the next several years, I traveled to several Latin American countries, I took some classes, and in the course of this, I found myself in Bolivia. And I was on a bus trip in a remote area, and the bus broke down, and it was serious enough that they told us to get off, which is never a good sign. And so as all the passengers were standing there on the side of the road, these women in traditional dress came out of the mountains and opened up these big colorful blankets onto the ground, and they began slicing chicken and cutting avocados and slicing bread and making sandwiches. And they sold these sandwiches to the passengers, including me. And of course, they did a brisk business because, you know, there's no better customer than someone stuck in the middle of nowhere on a broken bus. But it struck me then that, you know, capitalism was so much more than I thought it was. I had always thought that capitalism was the men in suits rushing from the train to Wall Street that I used to see when I was a boy in New Jersey. And I thought capitalism was the number that goes along the bottom of the screen for the Dow or the S&P. But I realized then that this was a much truer and deeper form of capitalism. And it struck me that if this could be harnessed somehow, that the energy and creativity of these women selling sandwiches could be applied to something else, then there's no telling what could be accomplished. And so a few years later, I became acquainted with Kiva. In fact, they were not even founded until right around the time that I got acquainted with them. And I was attracted to it for these three basic reasons. The first one is that it's not a gift, it's a loan. And so it encourages both the lender and the borrower to take it seriously, and it can be repeated. And then the second point, which is maybe most important to this presentation and maybe most important overall, is that you had the opportunity to read about and see a picture of your borrower, if you're the lender. And back in 2006, that seemed even more amazing than it does now. But the point is that with most charity, you just don't know exactly where your money's going. But with Kiva, you can literally put a face to every dollar. And then finally, it's a small, very efficient organization, and all of your money goes exactly where you want it to go. So the basic idea is you go on the website and you pick a borrower, and you can sort them based on country and occupation and environmental criteria and gender and all sorts of things. And then you make a loan of $25 or more, and then you wait some months or perhaps a couple of years, and you get the money back. And then you can either keep it, or hopefully you can send it back onto the website again and pick a different borrower. And then, if you like, you can just repeat this cycle. So if we take a look at my own lending page from a couple of years ago, I want you to notice there's a lot of information there, but I mainly want you to notice the part that's circled in red, which is the number of deposits and the number of loans. So until this point, I'd only ever spent approximately $250 of real money, and yet I've been able to lend a little over $1,000. So that's essentially a 5-to-1 gain. And if you're a person of modest means, like a teacher, it's nice to think that you can do a little bit more with your money. And so a year and a half ago, I got this amazing opportunity to go on sabbatical and to become a Kiva Fellow, which meant spending 4 months or so in Peru and Ecuador. And there were a lot of wonderful things that happened on this trip, but the important one for this discussion is what I call the Wizard of Oz moment. And what I mean by that is that as wonderful as the write-ups of the borrowers are on the webpage, when you actually get to meet one of them, you realize that there's even more to it than that. And so to illustrate that, this is Victoria Mendoza, and I met her eventually, like I read her profile. This is what you would see if you saw her on the website. And so it's great. I mean, you get a picture, you get some really good information, but I actually got to meet her. And when I met her in person, this is a picture that I took of her in her shop, and you can already start to get a sense that there's a lot more going on than the website necessarily, you know, revealed. And then I got to talk to her and so on. And so the italicized portions there are what it said on the website. And that's great, and it gives you an idea of who she is. But hopefully those are things that almost any borrower would say, or, you know, that would fit almost any borrower. But when I talked to her, she told me in person the part at the bottom, everything I've accomplished has been for my son. And when she said that, you know, suddenly she became much more of an individual and much more of a human to me. And I realized that that's where the empathy really starts to kick in, is when you actually meet the person. So it's nice to see them on the website, but it's even more when you meet them in person. So I would like to share just a couple more pictures and quotes from a couple of other borrowers to illustrate this point of how people can really come alive in various ways. So this is Dionisio, and he is a coffee grower, and he says a plant is like a Christian. And this one really struck me because I've done a lot of gardening myself, but I honestly never thought of it this way. But for him, apparently, you know, plants, it's almost like a religious experience. And I thought, what a great way to look at agriculture. And sometimes the borrowers are just fun, and they don't necessarily impart wisdom so much as they just, you know, want to have a good time with you. And so you can see from his smile and from what he says that Wilmer was just one of those people that was just fun. And I think that's an important thing to remember, too. And then I always like to include this one of medium because I think we tend to romanticize poverty sometimes a little bit, and I think that it's important to get past that. And so I think she really tells us both sides of it. On the one hand, she's happy with her situation, she's not complaining, she's not asking for pity, but on the other hand, she recognizes that it could be better, and she would like to be better for her children. When I started on this project, people asked me this question, what does microfinance have to do with teaching English? And I honestly didn't have an answer. I just thought that they were two different things that I cared about, and so I wanted to be able to do both of them if I could, but they were sort of on parallel tracks. And then, as part of the Kiva Fellowship, I had to do a training in San Francisco, and during that training, I had this sort of epiphany, and I realized that there is, in fact, a connection, and the connection is that Kiva is where a good story can change a life. And of course, stories are what English teachers are preoccupied with. And so I don't know if students always appreciate this, but the reason that we make you read things that you may not always want to read is, I think, mostly to get at that sense of empathy. Of course, we want you to write well and do all those other things, but the books that you encounter in English class tend to tell you stories about other people, just as the website of Kiva tells you stories about other people. And so stories, of course, are composed of sentences. And what I find remarkable about a lot of the material on Kiva is that there's nothing fancy about it. It's just a very simple statement about a person, and yet I think that can be one of the best ways of bridging some of the gaps that we have, whether it's distance or other things. We have all heard about a lot of the bad things that are going on in the world, and I think that really sometimes maybe we focus a little too much on this, because in my experience, having traveled to over 50 countries, there's a tremendous amount of hope. And of course, there is despair as well, but when you look at statistics like this, I think it can be a little bit misleading. And when you hear stories, on the other hand, and you look at people like this, and you meet them, if you're lucky, you start to realize that there's another side of it. And so, people that are separated by all these things, you just sometimes takes only a sentence or two to bridge that gap. So I just picked these three sentences as examples of what I'm trying to talk about here. And these are sentences that appeared on the Kiva website. And so the first one is about delivering bread on a bicycle. And I just think that that's kind of a reminder of sort of the mechanics of life that people have to deal with sometimes. Maybe in some sense that's a nicer way to do it, but it's certainly not an easier way to do it. And so I think when you read a sentence like that from our perspective in the U.S., it really makes you think about a different life. And then the second example is about a woman who has many difficulties of her own and many children to care for, and yet she's voluntarily taking on extra people, extra children to care for. And then the third one is interesting because it's not really about survival so much, but it's about the idea of building a school and promoting culture. And it's important to remember that too, that microfinance is not just about helping people survive, but it's also about helping them build and get better at various things. So it seems to me that when you read a sentence like that, it sort of almost takes you into that person's life, and that's really the fundamental thing of empathy. But it doesn't have to be a lot to do that. It can be a very simple sentence or story. It's important to keep in mind with Kiva and with other forms of microfinance that we're talking about very small amounts of money. Most of the loans that I dealt with were maybe $300, $500, something like that. But there's something more important in the sense that these are people who've never had an opportunity before. And so regardless of the amount, it gives them the sense that they're in control, that they have some power over their own destiny. And from the other perspective, as a lender, you know, whether you're thinking about it or not, you are saying to this person that I'm interested in your story, I like your story, and I want to help you come up with a better ending to your story. And it's also important to note that microfinance has a real possibility of failure. Traditional charity, typically, you know, you expect that it's going to succeed, and if it doesn't, you might be upset, understandably. But with microfinance, you're taking that risk. And I think that's important because that means that on both ends, from the borrower and the lender, you know, you have a real incentive for this to work. And so a Kiva loan then in the end is really, I think, much more than the money, but it's about this idea that you have made an attempt to understand someone from a different country, different language, different culture, and so on, and you're willing to, you know, put some skin in the game in terms of a little bit of money to try to make sure that they can do what they want. And so, that's the power of narrative or empathy, and that's even magic. Thank you.
For 20 years, I've been designing puzzles, and I'm here today to give you a little tour, starting from the very first puzzle I designed through what I'm doing now. I've designed puzzles for books, printed things. I'm the puzzle columnist for Discover Magazine. I've been doing that for about 10 years. I have a monthly puzzle calendar. I do toys. Bulk of my work is in computer games. I did the puzzles for Bejeweled. I didn't invent Bejeweled. I can't take credit for that. But. So, very first puzzle, sixth grade, my teacher said, oh, let's see, that guy, he likes to make stuff. I'll have him cut out letters on construction paper for the board. I thought this was a great assignment. And so here's what I came up with. I started fiddling with it. I came up with this letter. This is a letter of the alphabet that's been folded just once. The question is, which letter is it? If I unfold it, and at one hand, it's not L. It could be an L, of course. So what else could it be? Yeah, a lot of you got it. Oh, yeah. So, clever thing. Now, that was my first puzzle. I got hooked. I mean, I created something new. I was very excited. Because, you know, I've made crossword puzzles, but that's sort of like filling in somebody else's matrix. This was something really original. I got hooked. I read Martin Gardner's columns in Scientific American, went on, and eventually decided to devote myself full-time to that. Now, I should pause and say, what do I mean by puzzle? A puzzle is a problem that is fun to solve and has a right answer. Fun to solve as opposed to everyday problems, which frankly are not very well designed puzzles. You know, that might have a solution, might take you a long time, nobody wrote down the rules clearly. Who designed this? It's like, you know, life is not a very well written story, so we have to hire writers to make movies. Well, I take everyday problems and I make puzzles out of them. And right answer, of course there might be more than one right answer, many puzzles have more of them. But as opposed to a couple other forms of play, toys and games, by toy I mean something you play with that doesn't have a particular goal. You can create one out of Legos, but you know, you can do anything you want. Or competitive games like chess, where, well, you're not trying to solve, you can make a chess puzzle, but the goal really is to beat another player. I consider that puzzles are an art form. They're very ancient. It goes back as long as there's written history. It's a very small form, like a joke, a poem, a magic trick, or a song. Very compact form. At worst, you know, they're throwaways. They're for amusement, but at best, they can reach for something more and create a memorable impression. The progression of my career that you'll see is looking for creating puzzles that have a memorable impact. So one thing I found early on when I started doing computer games is that I could create puzzles that will alter your perception. I'll show you how. Here's a famous one. So it's two profiles in black or a white face in the middle. This is called a figure ground illusion. The artist M.C. Escher exploited that in some of his wonderful prints. Here we have Day and Night. Here's what I did with figure and ground. So here we have figure in black. Here we have figure in white, and it's all part of the same design. The background to one is the other. Originally, I tried to do the words figure and ground, but I couldn't do that, and I realized I changed the problem. It's all figure. A few other things. Here's my name, and that turns into the title of my first book, Inversions. These sorts of designs now go by the word ambigram. I'll show you just a couple others. Here we have the numbers of 1 through 10, the digits 0 through 9 actually. Each letter here is one of these digits. Not strictly an ambigram in the conventional sense. I like pushing on what an ambigram can mean. Here's the word mirror. No, it's not the same upside down. It's the same this way. And a marvelous fellow from the Media Lab just got appointed head of RISD is John Maeda. And so I did this for him. It's sort of a visual canon. And recently in Magic Magazine, I've done a number of anagrams on magicians and inks, so here we have Penn and Teller. Same upside down, this appears in my my puzzle calendar. Okay, let's go back to the slides. Thank you very much. Now, those are fun to look at. Now, how would you do it interactively? For a while, I was an interface designer, and so I think a lot about interaction. Well, let's first of all simplify the vase's illusion, make the thing on the right. Now, if you could pick up the black vase, it would look like the figure on top. If you could pick up the white area, it would look like the figure on the bottom. Well, you can't do that physically, but on a computer you can do it. Let's switch over to the PC. And here it is, figure ground. The goal here is to take the pieces on the left and make them so they look like the shape on the right. And this follows the rules I just said. Any black area that's surrounded by white can be picked up. But that's also true of any white area. So here we've got the white area in the middle, and you can pick it up. I'll just go one step further. So here's a couple pieces, move them together. And now this is an active piece. So you can really get inside somebody's perception and have them experience something. It's like the old maxim of you can tell somebody something and show them, but if they do it, they really learn it. Here's another thing you can do. There's a game called Rush Hour. This is one of the true masterpieces in puzzle design besides Rubik's Cube. So here we have a crowded parking lot with cars all over the place. The goal is to get the red car out. It's a sliding block puzzle. It's made by the company Think Fun. It's done very well. I love this puzzle. Well, let's play one here. So here's a very simple puzzle. Well, it's too simple. Let's add another piece. Okay, so how would you solve this one? Well, move the blue one out of the way. Here, let's make it a little harder. Still pretty easy. Now I'm making it harder, a little harder. Now this one's a little bit trickier. What do you do here? The first move is going to be what? You're going to move the blue one up in order to get the lavender one to the right. And you can make puzzles like this one that aren't solvable at all. Those four are locked in a pinwheel, you can't get them apart. I wanted to make a sequel. I didn't come up with the original idea, but this is another way I work as an inventor, is to create a sequel. I came up with this, it's Railroad Rush Hour. It's the same basic game, except I introduced a new piece, a square piece that can move both horizontally and vertically. In the other game, the cars can only move forward and back. Created a whole bunch of levels for it, now making it available to schools, and it includes exercises that show you not just how to solve these puzzles, but how to extract the principles that will let you solve mathematical puzzles or problems in science, other areas. So I'm really interested in you learning how to make your own puzzles as well as just me creating them. Gary Trudeau calls himself an investigative cartoonist. You know, he does a lot of research before he writes a cartoon. In Discover magazine, I'm an investigative puzzle maker. I got interested in gene sequencing, and I said, well, how on earth can you come up with a sequence of the base pairs in DNA? Cut up the DNA, and you sequence individual pieces, and then you look for overlaps, and you basically match them at the edges. And I said, that's kind of like a jigsaw puzzle, except the pieces overlap. So here's what I created for Discover magazine, and it has to be solvable in a magazine. You can't cut out the pieces and move them around. So here's the 9 pieces, and you're supposed to put them into this grid, and you have to choose pieces that overlap on the edge. There's only one solution. It's not that hard, but it takes some persistence. And when you're done, it makes this design, which if you squint, is the word helix. So that's the form of a puzzle coming out of the content, rather than the other way around. Here's a couple more. Here's a physics-based puzzle. Which way will these fall? One of these weighs 50 pounds, 30 pounds, and 10 pounds, and depending on which one weighs which amount, they'll fall different directions. And here's a puzzle based on color mixing. I've separated this image into cyan, magenta, yellow, black, the basic printing colors, and then mixed up the separations, and you get these peculiar pictures. Which separations were mixed up to make those pictures? Gets you thinking about color. Finally, what I'm doing now. So shufflebrain.com, website you can go visit. I joined up with my wife, Amy Jo Kim. She could easily be up here giving us a talk about her work. So we're making smart games for social media, and I'll explain what that means. We're looking at 3 trends. This is what's going on in the games industry right now. First of all, for a long time, computer games meant, things like Doom, where you're going around shooting things, very violent games, very fast, aimed at teenage boys, right? That's who plays computer games. Well, guess what? That's changing. Bejeweled is a big hit. It was the game that really broke open what's called casual games. And the main players are over 35 and are female. Then recently, Rock Band's been a big hit. and it's a game you play with other people. It's very physical. It looks nothing like a traditional game. This is what's becoming the dominant form of electronic gaming. Now, within that, there's some interesting things happen. There's also a trend towards games that are good for you. Why? Well, we aging boomers, you know, baby boomers, we're eating our healthy food, we're exercising. What about our minds? Oh no, our parents are getting Alzheimer's, we better do something. Turns out doing crossword puzzles can stave off some of the effects of Alzheimer's. Well, so we got games like Brain Age coming out for the Nintendo DS, huge hit. A lot of people do Sudoku, in fact some doctors prescribe it. And then there's social media of what's happening on the internet. Everybody now considers themselves a creator and not just a viewer. And what does this add up to? Here's what we see coming. It's games that fit into a healthy lifestyle. They're part of your life. They're not necessarily a separate thing. And they're both something that's good for you and they're fun. I'm a puzzle guy. My wife is an expert in social media and we decided to combine our skills. Our first game is called Photograb. The game takes about a minute and 20 seconds. This is your first time playing my game. Okay, let's see how well we can do. There are three images and we have 24 seconds each. Where is that? And I'll play as fast as I can, but if you can see it, I'll shout out the answer. You get more point. Down, okay, yeah, where's that? Okay, J-O, and that part. We got the bow, that bow helps. That's his hair. And then he had a lot of figure ground problems. That one's easy. Okay, so, and then, on to the next one. Okay, so that's the lens. Okay, anybody? Looks like a black shape, but okay, so what's that? That's the corner of the whole thing. Yeah, you know, I've played this image before, but I get, even when I make up my own puzzles, and you can put your own images in here, and we have people all over the world doing that now. There we are. Visit shufflebrain.com if you want to try it yourself. Thank you.
Y-Chun-C is our next speaker this afternoon. With empathy, a step closer to utopia. Y-Chun-C is currently a senior at Cranbrook Kingswood High School. Having moved around the world due to his parents' professions, he has been living in various countries and met people from different cultures and walks of life. After his formal introduction to service through Scouts and UNICEF, he has been active in his pursuits in volunteerism, especially in foreign service. He will be attending Swarthmore College in the fall with plans to study medical anthropology, philosophy, and psychology. So please give it up for Wong Chai Song.
I met Jia Zhi when I was about 10 years old. He was your average kid who liked comics and played video games. But despite we're the same age and like the same things, we're very different from each other. While I was the chubby 10-year-old who liked playing video games and my greatest worry was not getting dessert at the end of dinner, he was a quiet kid whose demeanor was dulled by the experiences of his life. But most importantly, he lost both his arms during the earthquake in Sichuan. It was on May 12, 2008, when an 8.5 magnitude earthquake struck the heart of Sichuan. I remember sitting in class, 800 miles away from the epicenter of the earthquake, feeling a small vibration in the classroom. Little did I know, later when I found out that, like Jia Zhi and my friend Fabi, there were thousands of other victims that were incapacitated by the rubble, waiting for the rescuers to reach them. Meeting him for the first time was a shock for the both of us. But it was through my trips to his hometown and his trips to mine where I realized we really had a lot of difference in the way we lived and the different tasks in life we had. Well, he taught me how he ate without his two arms and how he used his prosthesis. I showed him my prized Pokemon collection in my bedroom. But despite his handicap, he was rarely seen with his prosthesis because when I later found out that it was really heavy and cumbersome. But during one night when I was having dinner with him and his family and one of his donors, I saw him wearing his prosthesis, and he was slowly working his way through his dinner, you know, sometimes spilling a bit of sauce or porridge and blah. And one of the donors asked him a question in English, and she said, "How's your prosthesis going?" And as you know, that judge didn't speak English, so he stared at her blankly. And amid that silence, I heard from someone on the table that the prosthesis is holding up pretty well. We're hoping to get a new one next year, so Jiaju would have an easier time. Prior to meeting Jiaju, I knew suffering from a distance, sheltered by my privilege. And life was never the same for him after the earthquake. And its problems that they never expected popped up after the earthquake, and they had to rely on the donor's money in order to sustain the judge's future. However, something that I realized is Zemcha didn't really have a choice, because he had to, in order to get these funds, he had to demonstrate to the donors that the way he's using the money is manifested in useful means where the donors could see. 9 years later, traveling halfway across the world for boarding school in the States, and going to my first medical service trip in Haiti after Hurricane Matthew, I was transformed and transported in a different world, a different place. And as I was driving around Port-au-Prince after delivering supplies to a prison in nearby Port-au-Prince, we stopped by a local supermarket for lunch. And in the supermarket, there was pretty tall wall surrounding the supermarket. And inside that supermarket, there was rows of cars, such as Land Rovers, BMWs, and Fords, that each reflected the harsh glare of the sunlight. And stepping inside, I was transported into a different realm. There were rows and rows of consumer goods that towered over you. You could find Häagen-Dazs ice cream, Hot Pockets, Arnold Palmer. I would even argue that the supermarket there had products that were even more diverse than some stores in the States. But outside, beyond that wall, there were children drinking unfiltered water out of the well. And that sight infuriated me and was the impetus for me to go and try my best to provide the most I can while I was in Haiti. And here you can see the supermarket that was there. And then the children that were outside drinking unfiltered water from the well. But nevertheless, with my passion, the reality was still there. We lacked basic medications for blood pressure and diabetes, and diseases that were often curable in the first world countries were now incurable because of a lack of resources. Later that day, when I visited an orphanage to provide medical checkups to the orphans there, I met a group of teenagers who were just like me, eager to help and make a difference in this world. And before the teenagers left, they gave these keepsake bracelets to the kids there. And later that day, when I came back to provide more medical checkups, I saw that the orphans weren't wearing those keepsake bracelets the teens gave them when they left. To me, a young romantic whose dreams were always to help the underprivileged, it seemed as if it was all a facade for the teens to come help and play with the orphans. My dreams of helping others became disillusioned as I realized that most of what we did was kind of useless, having no lasting impact on the children. ask myself, was I contributing to part of the culture that was coming in and exploiting the underprivileged? But looking back, I realized that, like Tiatra, they had no other choice in order to sustain themselves and provide themselves with food, water, and shelter. And it was only interacting and living with the local Haitians when I realized the true needs of Haiti. The Haitians need jobs, the orphans need education, and the elderly need adequate health care. Instead of blindly helping, I realized that we first need to understand the true needs of Haitians before we can provide adequate support for the recovery and growth. What also emerged from these interactions were lessons of ardent faith and generosity. At a church service, I saw those who had served the day before come in with their best attire, singing songs of praise and worship, despite their dire health problems. Before I left for Haiti, a mentor told me, do good well. And I never really completely understood what he meant by doing good well until I actually went forth to experience what it means to do good well. Because while we can always provide blind help to those who are less privileged than us, sometimes all these people need is someone willing to talk to them and understand their struggles and truly share their experiences with them.
Is Johnny Emerman, who is a 1994 alumni of Cranbrook Kingswood High School, with his presentation of After Cancer Diagnosis, A Mentor. Johnny Emerman is a young adult cancer survivor who strives to make sure no one fights cancer without the support of someone who's already triumphed over the disease. After being diagnosed with testicular cancer at the age of 26, Johnny decided to found Emerman Angels, a nonprofit organization which carefully matches a person touched by cancer, cancer fighter or survivor, with someone who has fought and survived the same type of cancer, a mentor angel. Emerman Angels now has more than 6,000 cancer survivors and more than 1,500 caregivers in its network, and has been featured by dozens of news organizations, including the Wall Street Journal, Harpo Radio's Oprah and Friends with Dr. Oz, CNN, TEDx, The Huffington Post, Men's Health, National Public Radio, Sirius XM, Satellite Radio's Dr. Radio, Channel 81, and the Clinical Journal of Oncology Nursing. Johnny received numerous awards for his humanitarian work. Johnny grew up in Bloomfield Hills, Michigan, and lives in Chicago. Let's give it up for Johnny Emerman.
One of my favorite TED Talk speakers is a woman by the name of Brené Brown. Brené Brown once made the statement that we're going through life's biggest challenges, life's biggest struggles, the two most powerful words in the world are me too. Me too. I'll tell you guys a little story. When I was 26 years old, a couple years out of college, felt like most 26-year-olds, trying to figure out my career. I finished with school, just living life, going on dates, hanging out with friends, nothing really out of the ordinary. I was in Ann Arbor, Michigan, on a Saturday night, shooting pool, three guys and three girls, having fun, hanging out. Typical Saturday night. All of a sudden, suddenly, the worst pain of my life, flips on like a light switch. What it felt like is someone literally took a knife and violently stabbed me directly in the left testicle. Again, I'm playing pool, I have no idea what's going on in my body. I dropped the pool stick out of my hands. I doubled over in pain. My friends looked at me and said, Johnny, you can't even stand up. You're in pain. We'll pick you up and carry you to the car and drive you to the hospital. And I looked at my friends as a pretty ignorant 26-year-old and said, I'm fine, guys. I'll figure this out. It's Saturday night. Don't worry. You guys have fun. I don't want to ruin Saturday night for you. And what I did, very stupid, but it's the truth, I literally started waddling like this out of the bar. And I waddled all the way down the street. People were staring at me. And I waddled all the way back to my car. And I finally found my car. And I opened the car doors and I swing my legs up and in, only to realize that my legs are locked in this position. I literally can't reach the pedals. I'm in such pain. I'm almost crying in pain. And I'm alone. And I'm thinking, what do I do? I can't drive. The only thing I can do is I eventually start to push on my quads, trying to get my legs down to reach the pedals. Minutes go by, I finally get my legs down, and I can drive the car, see, grab the steering wheel. Not long after, I'm in the hospital, and I've got a doctor looking at me in the eyes saying, really sorry, kid, you're in your 20s. This is not what I want to tell you, but you have advanced cancer. And as we all know, those words, immediately your life changes so quickly. What I found myself was immediately in treatment. My cancer started in my left testicle and spread up into the pelvis, abdomen, behind the kidneys, almost to the lungs. And immediately went into surgery. They had to cut the left testicle out. That was the first step. The second step, I had to bank sperm because most of us are going to be sterile and unable to have our own children. And the third step, I had a surgical implant called a port that was surgically implanted into the side of my arm. And a catheter line ran through the vein all the way to my heart. And then they sewed it up. And that was the access port for chemo every day. My chemotherapies were, in general, Monday through Friday, every day, for about 8 hours a day of chemo. Crazy side effects on chemo, like numbness in your fingertips and your toes, really affects your capillaries of chemo. You would have mouth sores in my throat sometimes, the size of my pinky nail. Obviously fatigue, sometimes you throw up, you're sick, you're tired. There's a lot of mental and physical challenges that come along with chemo, but I was very lucky. I was able to get through that. They scanned me after about 6 months of chemotherapy. Everything looked clear. And at that point, mentally and physically, I'm really knocked down, but I'm slowly starting to build back up. And about a year later, at 28 years old, I did a checkup CAT scan, and what I had was a recurrence, which means the original tumor comes back. It was testicular cancer, but this time four tumors behind my kidney, sort of near my spine. So at that point, we had to go immediately into surgery, did an 11-inch vertical incision through the abdomen, pretty much from the sternum down to the pubic bone. Human body is amazing, right? We're able to withstand cuts and surgeries like this. They took all my internal organs, the liver, the kidneys, the intestines, the stomach, completely outside the body, pushed them all the way to the side to get to the tumors, cut out the four tumors, put all the organs right back in, stitched the stomach muscle, and then about 60 staples vertically up and down. As you might imagine, I was not in the gym that night. It took a while to build back up and slowly get stronger again. The important part is when you have all this time in the cancer center, going through roughly 2 years of treatments, you have so much time to look around and see where the cracks are in the system. Who better to find ways to make the cancer world and system better for those who follow than those who've already been there? Those who've already lived through it, those who've already smelled it, seen the sights, read books there, watched movies there. You literally live in the hospital, for many of us, for years, right? You can't help but see what goes on. As I'm walking, many days, on chemo with my IV pole, walking down the hallway to the bathroom, leaving my room, the can't help but look in the other rooms and see who's behind the glass. And walk back to your own room. You see again who's behind the glass. You see so many people are isolated and alone and scared. Most people are all alone and scared. And anyone who works in hospitals and with people with cancer is aware that that's the harsh reality, that that's what happens. So looking at how people are isolated and alone, scared, with no one to talk to, and also being a young adult survivor who wanted to find a way to give back and look for a crack in the system, I tried to put two things together. And what we created was a way to inspire and to motivate and to help the people who are fighting cancer by creating a buddy system of support. The crack in the system, the crack was isolation. The crack was, why are people alone? Why don't they know people like them? Why are they so nervous going into this? What if they knew somebody who's actually already been there, who's beaten the same form of cancer, who wants to talk to them, help them, motivate them, encourage them, inspire them, help them cross that finish line because they already have? How do we create that solution? How do we bridge these two worlds? So we created an organization to solve this problem. It's called Emmerman Angels. There's about 8,000 volunteers who are cancer survivors and family members who've already been through a specific journey with cancer, and now they're on the other side. And we've recruited them, we trained them, we brought them into our system, and then we find people who are fighting cancer today, maybe diagnosed this morning, and buddy the best volunteer angel that we know who's the most similar with that person who's brand new. So nobody has to fight cancer alone, ever. And it's free. These are volunteers that do this because they care, and they're grateful, and they want to give back. So let me give you a couple of examples of our idea. Someone named Emily, who's 24, who lives in Burbank, California, gets diagnosed with carotid gland cancer, which is unusual in young people, unusual overall, on the side of her face. And she is worried about surgery being disfigured. She is worried about being on chemo and infertile, unable to have her own children. She's worried about finding a job, looking different, being confident enough to go in a job interview. All of these issues that Emily has, we need to hook her up with another girl named Allison, who lives in New York, who said, I'm 30 years old. When I was 24, I had the exact same carotid gland cancer. I get it, I've been there, I beat it, lost my hair on chemo, but here's a picture of me today. I will help you through this. They can Skype, they can FaceTime, they can email, they can text, even they can travel if they would like to visit each other. But one-to-one, Allison can give hope, knowledge, and inspiration. Someone like Emily Burbank. Another example of our one-on-one peer mentoring program is when the spouse is suffering through this cancer experience. Sometimes we have somebody who is fighting cancer who's 60, and we match them to a survivor, but their spouse says this is the hardest thing in the world. Getting them to treatment, emotionally dealing with it, myself, helping them stay positive, understanding all of this, all of these ins and outs of life that are so hard, making sure the kids are okay, all those challenges. We gotta hook that spouse up, the caregiver, with another caregiver that can say, I've gone through this as well. My spouse went through the same thing 5 years ahead of you. I have so many tips, so much knowledge. This works, this doesn't work. I can help you get through this. Trust me, there's a finish line. Trust me, life will get better. I'm going to help you stay positive when you need me to get there. The third application of what we do at Emmerman Angels is a sadder one, of course, but when someone loses someone to cancer, maybe it's a child, and a 10-year-old child gets diagnosed named Robbie with leukemia. And after a two-year battle, Robbie in Michigan doesn't make it. Those parents are isolated, scared. They don't know even who to talk to when they're friend and family network who really empathizes, who really understands. We need to get Robbie's family and parents matched with another set of parents that may live in Miami who say, we lost a child to leukemia as well at the same age 10 years ago. We've been there. We thought our lives were over. We stuck out this marriage. We got through it. Here's how we did it in year one. Here's how it was in year two, in year four, in year five. These parents essentially give a roadmap. They give a roadmap. They've been there. They walk this walk. They can say there's hope and there's knowledge that you need to know to get you to a better place. And what I've learned personally with people in this situation, what generally happens is that they'll say the thought of getting 50% happy again after losing a spouse or a child sounds like a dream, an unrealistic dream. 10 years later, 15 years later, what you hear from these people is that they're 95% happy. 95%. When you're in it, it's unimaginable. It's completely unattainable in our minds. 10 years later, 12 years later, with a lot of hard work and a lot of therapy and a lot of emotional evolution, these people say they're 95% happy. That gives so much hope, so much strength, and so much encouragement to those families who are just starting this journey. So in summary, as Brené Brown once said, we go through life struggles, the two most powerful words in the world are me too. This is what people need in the cancer world. They need to connect. The opportunity to connect with someone like you who's farther along, who can look you in the eye and say, me too, it gets better. That's how we build hope. That's how we build knowledge and strength and help every single family across this world cross that finish line and know that life is worth living. There's a light at the end of the tunnel. And that's what Intermittent Angel's mission is to do, bridge this cancer world. Thank you.
Oja is a budding entrepreneur and avid technologist whose work is primarily oriented around improving education, social mobility, and poverty alleviation. Teaching himself the basics of JavaScript in eighth grade, Sean's interest in programming has led him to explore fields in software from search engine optimization to artificial intelligence. He hopes that through continued effort, he can bring AI to the forefront of our society and help solve some of the world's most pressing issues. So please join me to welcome Sean.
So how many of you guys have ever seen the movie I, Robot?
Will Smith, Shia LaBeouf throwing a riot, a bunch of robots going crazy. Well, it's one of my favorite movies. Not just because Will Smith, my favorite actor, because it was the first movie I ever watched that showed me a real, like a somewhat real depiction of an artificial intelligence. Like this idea that humans could create something born of technology that seems human but is very distinct. And it's not just me. Media, cinema, they're all enamored by the idea of an artificial intelligence. The idea that like an AI could somehow rise and surpass humans. You guys know this guy, Ultron, from the Avengers? I think this guy epitomizes the way that we look at artificial intelligence. The idea that like we're going to create some kind of artificial being with personality very similar to a human, and yet he's going to be so different. But because of depictions like Ultron, people also think that AI is something that doesn't exist yet. And that's the question I'm going to ask. You know, does AI exist yet? Well, though you're not going to, on your drive home, you're not going to drive by Ultron. I can bet that each and every single one of you today has interacted with an artificial intelligence, and you didn't even know about it. See, artificial intelligence doesn't just exist today, but its modern incarnation has existed for over a decade. And it's in every single, and it exists every single day in your life. And if you don't believe me, I'm about to prove it to you.
Didn't you Google anything? Maybe when you're on your way to PAC or, you know, after you go, you're going to find a place to go to dinner. Well, if you have, then there's a good chance you interacted with an AI called RankBrain. RankBrain is Google's artificial intelligence that basically goes through a whole bunch of user profiles, right? And it learns what makes people similar and what makes them different. So that way, when you put in an order for something, it'll tell, or when you put in a search, it will tell you what you want, not just on what you typed in, but also because it knows who you are, and its intent is gained from there. Did you read the news by chance? Well, if so, there's a good chance that the article that you read was not written by a person, rather it was written by a robot. The Associated Press releases about 3,000 quarterly reports, and not one of them is written by a human. They're all written by an AI called Wordsmith. It takes raw data, goes through a formula, and then puts out a whole bunch of paragraphs about it. Same thing with Fox Sports. For baseball, what they do is they take raw data, give short post-game updates in the form of tiny little paragraphs and sentences. If you ever do fantasy football, you know that Yahoo Sports, you're probably wondering, like, who at Yahoo has time to write me this? Well, it's not. You've been lied to. It's a robot who wrote it all this time. So then you're probably wondering, okay, so if it's not this, you know, Ultron-esque artificial intelligence, but what is artificial intelligence? So in order to get to what artificial intelligence is, what AI is, you have to know what intelligence is itself. So psychologists and computer scientists, they tend to think of it as pattern recognition. The smarter you are, the better you'll be able to recognize patterns. For example, something that we consider dumb, like an ant, will keep bumping into a mirror, right? It doesn't know where it's going, it'll keep bumping until it dies. It's not people realizing that if I go into this mirror, like, I'm not going to be able to move forward. Then let's say a smarter animal, like a dolphin. A dolphin, if you put a mirror in the ocean, it might swim towards it, being another dolphin, it'll bump against it and realize, oh, I recognize that this object is not another dolphin, and I'll go swim away. But human, we're the most intelligent of all creatures. We don't even need to bump into a mirror to know that, okay, it's a mirror, we're not going to bump into it. So then, artificial intelligence basically is a computer program that's capable of recognizing patterns. What it does is, it runs the code, it gets a result, and then it uses that result to affect its own code. It rewrites its own algorithms, it reteaches itself. So with this, we have a whole capability, a whole bunch of possibilities about AI. Not just limited to fantasy sports. High speed trading firms like Citadel and Avia use artificial intelligence as core to their trading platform. What they do is they have an AI look at how the market's been doing over the past few months, and then we'll find a prediction for the next few months, and we'll act exclusively on that. There's very little human input in Citadel. They would rather hire a PhD in computer algorithms than they would someone with an MBA. Tesla, your new favorite car company, also is a heavy user of machine learning, the derivative of artificial intelligence. Each Tesla car is lined up with chock full of sensors that help determine not just the location of your car, but the location of other cars and where they were before. Then, the machine learning algorithm then determines not just where the car is, but where it will be in the next few seconds, which allows it to determine the location of cars in the future, and then it pretty much predicts the crash before it even happens. So, basically, artificial intelligence, its utility to us, as humans, is to automate. Why would I drive a car when I can have a car drive itself for me? Why would I hire brokers when I can have a computer make thousands of trades in 1 second? So ultimately, automation has major benefits, like it's easier, it's cheaper, it's faster. But with automation, you lose something very crucial, you lose control. And as we give artificial intelligence bigger and bigger tasks, we sacrifice things that are getting more and more important. In fact, one day, an artificial intelligence will have to choose between life and death. Because as we keep giving it more and more important tasks, we then put our own safety, our lives, at risk. Let me give you an example. So one day, I believe, we're going to have a fully automated transportation system. All cars are going to be part of some kind of car internet. And they're going to be able to interact with each other the same way, user profile. You won't have to do any driving. So let's take you to that view. Let's say 2035. So I'm going to introduce you to car one. Car 1 has one mother, she's a soccer mom, she's taking care of her youngest child, who's a toddler. They're both in the backseat, and they're on their way to school. And in the other car, we have one C-suite executive at a very major pharmaceutical company. And what's happening is these two cars are going opposite directions, and all of a sudden, due to some unknown error, there is some kind of crazy malfunction. And now these cars are headed going in on a head-on collision. So now you're probably asking yourself, all right, what can the computer system do to fix it? So the computer system realizes it's too late, and then runs a million calculations and realizes that you can only save two of the three lives. So that means either the toddler, the executive, or the mother dies. So in this case, we have a real dilemma. We have no idea, well, the computer has no idea how to calculate or how to justify taking one's life over the lives of others. Well, that's not entirely true. Computer scientists are trying to find multiple ways in which that we can derive a solution to this problem. So that's basically it. How can you create a formula? Can you program morality into computers? So there are two measures I'm going to talk about. First one is called, well, I dub it fiscal measure. The idea that we're going to weigh each person's life based on the net impact they have on society. So for example, that C-suite executive, if we say that he is to die, then what is the net impact on the rest of the world, on the rest of the economy? Well, when any normal company experiences some kind of shift in management, especially executive level, their stocks are going to plummet. So imagine if their C-suite executive, their CEO, dies. Investors would back out. Companies would lose millions of dollars in infrastructure. And as a result, the company may have to lay off hundreds, if not thousands, of people. Compare that to, say, the death of a toddler. Toddler doesn't employ anyone, doesn't contribute to the job force. Their death, as unfortunate as it would be much less impactful than the death of the executive. So if we were to implement this method, what would happen is thousands of dollars, millions of dollars possibly, would be saved. And we wouldn't even know about it. The model does ignore certain things, though. For example, it ignores potential. The idea that a child may be worth later on in the future, however, we can't recognize that immediately. But there's also another fatal flaw with this. The idea that, well, if you're influential, it's more likely it's because you're wealthy. And what happens when you put this method in, wealthy people are going to be kind of getting their privilege extended. Before, they just got to drive nicer cars, probably more safer cars, but now, with an AI guiding the system using this protocol, they're pretty much immune to car accidents. And what's even worse is, poor people are now facing an even greater amount of car accidents. So then there's the other measure, the social measure, the societal measure. Many people in philosophy dictate that our morals are determined by society. So if we're going to create a moral machine, we should have society determine it. So the people should decide who lives and who dies. So you might be wondering, how can you do this? You can't crowdsource that much information. It's such an infinitesimal time. So what we do is, it's an artificial intelligence, we teach it. What we do is we collect a whole bunch of information, be it a census, we kind of get some kind of sight together, and we learn from humans' morals. We learn from how they behave, and we learn from the way they treat each other. And then from that, we take the mean of all their answers. We collapse that, and we figure out, okay, this is the outcome that would leave the least amount of people unhappy. And in that case, most people would say, according to this one program by MIT called The Moral Machine, what they did is they ran hundreds of simulations like this. So you can actually participate in this right now if you want. You have to choose between who lives and who dies. And they found out that children are the least likely to die, and executives and criminals are more likely to die. So what happens is we have a quote-unquote socially optimal scenario, but is it really socially optimal? The issue with this is inherent within society itself, that we as a society are flawed. The fact that we have our own biases. And not only that, how is this going to scale? The views of society within one state, be it Texas, is very different than the views of one state, be it New York. And then when you scale it to a national level or an international level, you're going to have major disputes in who is going to determine what kind of AI it is. You know, is it going to be from New York? Is it going to be from Texas? Whose morals are we instilling within the robot itself? So ultimately what I want to get across here is the fact that no matter which method we use, no matter which computer algorithm we're smart enough to generate, it will fit. We will always be disappointed with our results, not because we're not good enough technologists, but because the idea of what we're doing itself is flawed.
In essence, we cannot outsource humanity. We can't let go of the part which makes us human. When we automize characteristics, we're doing things because they're too easy for us. But for things that are too difficult, like making decisions like these, we can never allow ourselves the opportunity to let this go. Now, I'm not trying to say that we should halt production of any artificial intelligence engines. AI, to me, still is the most fascinating field there is in computer science, and I want us to continue. But as we continue in this field, I want us to remember that we're the creators, we're the builders, we're the makers, and we're the ones who are going to be maintaining them, fueling them, controlling them. We can't allow artificial intelligence to control us or determine our life paths. Thank you.
Sakshi Ahmed is our final presenter tonight. She is a junior at Cranbrook Kingswood, and she enjoys figure skating and has been practicing her skills for roughly 14 years. Sakshi is interested in pursuing business and hopes to move to the West Coast eventually. Give it up for Sakshi.
It decreases your memory and kind of gives a lot of problems to your motor functions. So I'm going to ask you another question. What does Alzheimer's mean to you? I'll give you some time to think about this. So to me, Alzheimer's is something that is kind of close to me. My grandpa, or as I used to call him, my nana, had it. This disease lasts a very long time for him. He almost had it for 10 years. About a year ago, he passed away. So I'll give you some background on his life. He was about a teacher and a principal for almost 50 years in India. He was an English professor, and even after school, he would give tutoring. And he would tutor kids with science and English after school, every day after school. So he was a very, very smart man, and seeing this disease take so much away from him, it was kind of heartbreaking. So a symptom of Alzheimer's is called retrogenesis, which I have seen in him. So what might this be? A symptom of Alzheimer's is what this is. Retrogenesis is when a person's brain is basically backtracked into their childhood. So as he got older, he started hoarding a lot of things like my books or my hairpins or my hair clips. And I felt like this was something he may have done when he was younger. He would always ask me, my sister, or my cousins to go and try to find them, like hide and seek. In his case, as I told you, he was an English professor. So he used to forget how to speak English, and then he would go back to talking in his native language like he did when he was a kid. So sometimes my daughter became anxious, and this is another symptom of Alzheimer's. They get angry, emotional, and you didn't understand what was happening. So I kept asking myself, why? What did he do to deserve this? And then as years went on, and as I got older, and as he got older, it started getting worse, and I came to understand that this really isn't his fault. And another question I would ask myself is, how can I help? So I just decided that maybe he just needs patience. As teenagers, that's the one thing we can give him. So he would always ask me every single time I saw him, how old was I? What grade was I in? What did I want to be when I grow up? And this was the three questions he would ask me constantly, anytime I would see him. It would be after school, in the morning, every day. And I used to get frustrated, but then I had to remember that I had to step back and understand that this isn't his fault. This was just the disease talking. So what I decided to do is I wanted to help him in some way. So after he passed away, I didn't really know what to do without him, so I started attending Alzheimer's walks, and I used to walk around all the time with across Lansing, in Grand Rapids, anywhere where they would have one. And then I decided, why don't I just start attending some support groups and some seminars? So one day, I actually took my family along with me to a seminar about Alzheimer's, and I saw this thing called the virtual dementia tour. And this tour itself is actually quite heartbreaking because you get to step into people's shoes with Alzheimer's and see what they deal with on a daily basis. So I thought, well, researchers and scientists and doctors are trying to find a cure for this. I thought maybe I could do something to bring peace with my family and other families who are dealing with this. So I decided to attend a certification program for the virtual dementia tour. It was a 6-hour course, and after that I was certified. So in this tour, basically what you do is you have gloves, you have glasses, you have a headset, you have these things in your shoes that hurt a lot. And these are just a few of the things that people with Alzheimer's may have. And what it does is you walk into a room, a very dark room with strobe lights. And with these strobe lights, what they do is they kind of show you what the person is seeing when they walk in somewhere. And the headset itself has very loud noises, like sirens, people talking, so it's like there's voices in your head. You're given 5 tasks, and they might be easy tasks, like fill a cup with water, or maybe hang some clothes, or even writing a simple letter, writing just a word. And you may think it's easy, but having the headset, having everything happening with the gloves, as arthritis and as the glasses, as cataracts, it's harder than what you would think it would be. So I have taken this tour twice, and each time I've probably only gotten 1 or 2 tasks. And I thought when walking into it that, oh, this is going to be easy, I'll be able to figure it out, I can do this. But walking out of that, it kind of changed. I wouldn't say it changed me as a person, I would say that it changed my mindset. That all these people are getting frustrated with people who have dementia. They're getting frustrated because they keep asking the same questions, they can't do a simple task. And after experiencing this, I saw them in a whole new light. That they go through daily struggles just to get out of bed, just to pour a glass of water, just to wash their hands or their face or anything. And this whole experience for me, it opened up a new light. And I kind of advise everyone, if you have the chance, go find some place to take this tour. The tour was made by this company called Second Wind Dreams, and they do a lot of research into Alzheimer's. They do a lot of Alzheimer's awareness, and this is where the tour started itself. So, as a conclusion to what I'm trying to say is that you ever encounter someone, you have a grandparent or an aunt or someone who's showing symptoms of Alzheimer's or who has Alzheimer's, it's something that you should try to understand and try to see their point of view in this case. It's heartbreaking to see them go through this, but there's things that you can do to help. There's obviously the whole theme of this TED Talk is empathy, so you can just try to give them some of that. They deserve that at least. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is R. Brown, and I just want to share a couple of quick thank yous with you all. First and foremost, I think we need to give it up one more time for our speakers. Really, the speakers on the journey, we learned everything from big history to Haiti. We learned about the importance of compassion in cancer to the impact that classical music can have on all of us. But in order to put this great thing together, we had a lot of people working behind the scenes. We had speech coaches that were working with individuals. We had a great tech crew, whether it was Jeremy or Dan or Alec or Hannah, that really put this together. So let's give it up for all the folks behind the scenes. We also want to thank our organizers, our division directors, but one person in particular, and that's Katie Mexi, who really has a lot of love. Thank you very much for bringing this to us this year. And last but not least, we want to thank all of you. Thank you for coming out tonight.